When despair for the world grows in me, and I wake in the night at the least sound, in fear of what my life or my children's lives may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests in his beauty on the water and the great heron feeds.
I was born in Auckland, New Zealand, which is at the bottom of the world. I was amazingly awarded a government scholarship to go and study acting in England. And I auditioned for drama school there, for the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art. And then I was invited to do an audition for the Royal Shakespeare Company, which was my dream. And so I did 5 auditions for the Royal Shakespeare Company and started there in their following season playing Olivia in Twelfth Night opposite Judi Dench playing Viola. I had just come back from Australia where I'd been making a film called The Last Days of Shenu in 1991. And I got an invitation from Greenpeace saying, would I be a celebrity speaker at a rally for whales that they were having in Trafalgar Square? So Tim, my son, who was 8, and I and the nanny went to Trafalgar Square. And up in the front, there was a man talking and somebody said, well, that's Roger Payne. He's the man who discovered humpback whales sing. Well, I didn't know humpback whales sang. And at the end, Roger was at the bottom of the stairs as I was coming off the plinth where the lions are. And he started talking to me. And I just vanished into his mind. I mean, he was charming and his voice was beautiful. And 10 weeks after the day we met, we were married in Woodstock, Vermont. Roger brought into our lives such a wealth of knowledge and experience, and I began realizing that there were things going wrong with the world that I'd never realized before because, you know, he's working with oceans. And, well, the first thing I realized was that fish were being threatened. Faxes used to come through from people out in the field and the death of whole fisheries. And so gradually, just through my life with him, through discussing the things that he was working on, I kept thinking, how blessed am I that I have had this extraordinarily interesting life, but it's been leading to this point where suddenly I meet this human being who has so much to give us, takes care of us, and loves us, and at the same time opens up more doors than you could possibly imagine.
Another recital program I used to do called The Hollow Crown, and that's Patrick Stewart in A Younger Life. That's my son graduating from high school. That's Pygmalion. This is Glenda Jackson, my first film I made in Rome, and with Glenda Jackson, and that's me and Claudio Casanelli. This is Judi Dench.
I put us in Vermont, in the middle of the countryside, because I wanted my son to have experience of living in a green world. I got an agent and I kept going down to, you know, I was in a film that won Sundance. I thought, well, next step, Hollywood, right? No, wrong, very wrong. I ended up not working for 2 years, and that was a real shock to me because all my life as an actress, I had never been out of work, ever. I had by choice when I had my baby, but never. I mean, I always went from one job to the next, and suddenly for 2 years I was out of work. But the great thing was I had Roger, so we went off on the most amazing adventures for the Ocean Alliance and traveling and going and see grey whales. But I was very, very anxious deep down that I had somehow lost my way as an actor, as an artist. And then a miracle happened. There was a play on in New York called Wit, which was written by Margaret Edson and won the Pulitzer Prize, and Kathleen Chalfont was doing it in New York, and I got the part. I was astounded. So suddenly, my first job after 2 years was in that amazing play off Broadway. And now the interesting thing is that Roger and I, together, are both appearing off Broadway in a production of our show, which is now called Sea Change Reversing the Tide, the one for which I wrote the book all those years ago. So life has come full circle.
The area needed to keep up with our demands sustainably now equals the surface of this entire planet plus an area equal to the agricultural regions of Europe and Australia.
The reason I wrote What Can I Do is because a few years back, Roger had this passion for us to do something together. So he wrote this piece, which used to be called Lessons from Copernicus. And it was a combination of science and poetry, what he calls the the knowledge of science and the wisdom of poetry. And it was about sustainable living, why humanity has to live sustainably and why we have to recognize our place in nature, that we're not outside nature or above nature. We are utterly interconnected with nature. And if nature goes wrong, everything will go wrong for us.
If we do not begin to work together for the well-being of each other, the planet surge of life may well be done with.
The monolithic indifference of natural laws to our preferences is total. They will never adapt to our desires, not even once. It is we who must adapt to them, always, every time, no exceptions.
The whales turn and glisten, plunge and sound and rise again, flowing like breathing planets in the sparkling whorls of living light.
We did it at Cornell University and a couple of other places, and people began saying to us, yeah, we get the message, so what can I do? And that really registered with me, and I just got this bee in my bonnet. I thought, well, I'm going to write a book called What Can I Do? And the thing was that at the same time as we were working on the show, I was learning from the internet, which I'd never used before, what was happening in the world that was just fantastic about the solutions to the problems that the world had. And Roger would be writing and getting very depressed about oceans and fish and air and loss of topsoil. And I would be saying, no, but you see, there's this person doing this and that person doing this, and there's this organization over here doing this and someone else doing this.
Humanity's worst problems are solvable. Most solutions are simple. Existing scientific understanding is strong enough to get us started.
There is, in fact, a new industrial revolution underway that can prevent us from laying waste to the beauty of the world.
I decided to write a book using an old alphabet, children's alphabet, as a model, and putting into it all these little groovy websites that I'd found that I really loved. We self-published a little handbook called What Can I Do? And Margot Baldwin down at Chelsea Green came across a copy. And she rang me up and she said, we'd like to publish this. Could you write more? So I sat down to write What Can I Do? An alphabet for living. It is possible for the world, if we come together and work together, to change the way we're living, to really acknowledge the problems that we're giving to the living systems of the Earth. We must now take responsibility for it and start to heal the systems that we are causing terrible problems to. So I've found a whole new life, and it's wonderful. It's really, really, really fun. I've set up something called the Sea Change Institute, which is a branch of Ocean Alliance, which is Roger's Institute. The mission statement for the Sea Change Institute. The Sea Change Institute is a non-profit organization that works to change public perception about the importance of the environment. If civilization is to survive, the health of the environment must trump all concerns, and each of us must make restoring the Earth and the Earth's health a primary goal of our lives. Now, the Institute is working as a non-partisan grassroots campaign to make the environment central to the platforms of all politicians in all future elections.